Today, we're going to look at walks, trails, and paths in simple hypergraphs. To begin, a walk in a hypergraph is a sequence of alternating vertices and edges in that hypergraph, such that all consecutive pairs of vertices V sub I and V sub I minus 1 are adjacent through edge E sub I. That is, V sub I and V sub I minus 1 are distinct vertices that share an incident edge. As an example, A, E sub 1, A, E sub 1, B would not be a walk because the same vertex, A, appears consecutively. The vertices that appear in the walk are known as the anchors of the walk. The first and final vertices appearing in the walk are known as the endpoints, and the rest of the vertices are called the interior vertices. You can think of a walk as a movement through a hypergraph where we're allowed to move from one vertex to any distinct vertex that shares an edge with it, and that we're allowed to come back to the same vertex later in our walk and repeat edges as well. Like in graph theory, the length of a walk is the number of edges appearing in its sequence. Also like in graph theory, if the last vertex of a walk is the same vertex as the first vertex of the walk, we say the walk is closed. If not, we say it's open. Here's an example of a walk in a hypergraph. In this example, our walk is closed because it started and ended with vertex A. Note that we visited edge E sub 2 three times and vertex B twice. Moving on, it's important to know that a walk in a hypergraph corresponds to a walk in the incidence graph of that hypergraph. For example, the incidence graph of the hypergraph in our previous example is this, and the walk we just looked at corresponds to the following walk in the incidence graph. Next, just like in graph theory, we might want to define some specific types of walks by imposing restrictions. Let's think about how we can generalize the notion of path from graph theory, which is a walk that doesn't repeat vertices. First, unlike in graph theory, if we impose the restriction that all vertices in the walk have to be distinct, we don't automatically get that all the edges in the walk are distinct. As for edges with more than two vertices, we might be able to use the same edge multiple times without visiting the same vertex multiple times. So in hypergraph theory, we define two notions of a path. A hyperpath, which is the weaker notion that restricts all vertices to be distinct, but allows for repeated edges. And a path, which restricts all vertices and edges in the walk to be distinct. All paths are hyperpaths, but not all hyperpaths are paths. Let's look at a couple examples to demonstrate this. In this hypergraph, A, E sub 1, B, E sub 2, D, E sub 3, F is a path, while A, E sub 1, B, E sub 2, C, E sub 2, D, E sub 2, F is a hyperpath. Note that, like walks, hyperpaths and paths can be either closed or open, depending on whether the last vertex is the same as the first vertex. We have a special term for closed paths and closed hyperpaths. A closed hyperpath is a hypercycle, and a closed path is a cycle. As an exercise, is this closed walk a hypercycle or a cycle? It's a hypercycle, because while no vertices are repeated in this closed walk, there is a repeated edge, E sub 1, meaning it can't be a cycle. One reason why our definitions of path and hyperpath are nice is because from an incidence graph perspective, paths and hyperpaths in the hypergraph are special kinds of walks in the incidence graph. Specifically, a path in a hypergraph H is a path in the incidence graph G of H, and a hyperpath in H is a walk in G of H that doesn't visit any of the vertices corresponding to vertices in the hypergraph more than once. To demonstrate, here's the incidence graph of a previous example. The path in our hypergraph, A E sub 1, B E sub 2, F, clearly corresponds to a path in the incidence graph. The hyperpath, A E sub 1, B E sub 2, C E sub 2, F, is not a path in the incidence graph because we end up visiting vertex E sub 2 multiple times. We also go over the same incidence graph edge multiple times, so it's not even a trail in the incidence graph. But it is a walk that doesn't repeat vertices that correspond to vertices in the hypergraph. Now that we've generalized paths and walks in hypergraphs, you might be wondering, what's the generalization of a trail? Well, just like with paths, there's more than one interesting way that we can generalize trails. We're going to cover two in this video, trails and strict trails. The walk V sub 0, E sub 1, V sub 1, and so on up to V sub n, where the different V sub i's and E sub i's are not necessarily distinct, is said to be a trail if the ordered pairs V sub 0, E sub 1, V sub 1, E sub 1, V sub 1, E sub 2, V sub 2, E sub 2, and so on are all distinct. These ordered pairs are just a 2n tuple of ordered pairs where the first entry is a vertex in our walk and the second entry is an edge that appears immediately before or after that vertex in our walk. Note that any ordered pair VE where V is a vertex, E is an edge, and V is incident to E is referred to as a flag, and that the flags in a hypergraph are the same as the edges of its incidence graph. This is going to be useful later on. We'll refer to this 2n tuple of ordered pairs as a tuple of flags associated with our walk. So, what's the intuition behind this definition of trail? When all the edges have two vertices, as in graph theory, this definition is equivalent to the definition of trail in graph theory. As if we repeat an edge AB in a walk through a simple graph, the flags AAB and BAB would have to appear at least twice in the tuple of flags corresponding to our walk, and the converse is also true. Now, in hypergraph theory, we can have edges with more than two vertices, which allow us to construct trails like the following that do repeat edges. So, the interpretation from graph theory, which is that a trail does not repeat edges, no longer applies in hypergraph theory. So how do we interpret this type of trail in hypergraphs? A trail in a hypergraph just means that if a pair of a vertex V and edge E appear in consecutive positions in our walk, that pair cannot appear in consecutive positions ever again in our walk. Intuitively, this means we can't move out of a vertex the same way more than once, and we can't move into a vertex the same way more than once. And we can never move out of a given vertex the same way we moved into it. As an exercise, is the following walk in this hypergraph a trail? It's not a trail because we moved into V sub 2 using E sub 1, and then we moved out of V sub 2 using E sub 1, which is not allowed. If we think about hypergraph trails from an incidence graph perspective, a trail in a hypergraph turns out to be a trail in the incidence graph too. As for why this is, think back to the fact that every flag in the hypergraph is an edge in the incidence graph. And our definition of trail was a walk that essentially doesn't repeat flags. So in the incidence graph, our trail is a walk that does not repeat edges, or in other words, a graph trail. As an example, in this hypergraph, V1, E3, V2, E1, V3, E3, V4 is a trail. And notice that in the incidence graph, it's also a trail. Now, what if we wanted to define a walk where the edges are distinct? That brings us to our last generalization of trails to hypergraphs, strict trails. A strict trail is a walk that requires the edges to be distinct. Note that all strict trails are trails, as with no repeated edges, all the flags will be distinct for our walk. But as we discussed earlier, not all trails will be strict trails. As an example, here's a strict trail in this hypergraph. Moving on, let's look at strict trails from the perspective of incidence graphs. A strict trail in a hypergraph H is a trail in the incidence graph of H. As we already covered that all strict trails are trails and the trails in the hypergraph are trails in the incidence graph. However, it's a special type of trail. It cannot visit any of the vertices in the incidence graph that correspond to edges in the hypergraph more than once. Here's a demonstration of this using our previous example. Moving on, our definition of path in a hypergraph is useful for constructing a notion of distance in a hypergraph. We can define the distance between two vertices in a hypergraph to be the length of the shortest path between them, just like in graph theory. Note that if there are a pair of vertices that do not have a path joining them, we define their distance to be infinity. In this hypergraph, what's the distance between vertices V3 and V4? First, list out all paths between V3 and V4, and find the length of the shortest path. The shortest path has length 2, the number of edges that appear in it, so the distance between V3 and V4 is 2. Using this definition of distance, we can define the diameter of a hypergraph to be the maximum distance between any pair of vertices in that hypergraph. In the hypergraph shown here, the diameter is 3 because that's the length of the longest, shortest path between any pair of vertices. Also, like in graph theory, we can define connectedness for hypergraphs using paths. A hypergraph is connected if for any pair of distinct vertices, there's a path between them. We can define the connected components of a hypergraph to be its maximal connected subhypergraphs. For example, in this hypergraph, what are the connected components? Here they are, subhypergraphs C1 and C2. That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe and click the like button. Have a great day.